I'm standing on the Garth Mountain in South Wales. Below me is the Taff Valley. Who was Taff? No one really knows. What we do know is that Welshmen have been called Taff since time began. From here we can see the village of Taff's Well. You could say time has stood still here. We know the Romans came as they discovered a thermal spa similar to the one at Bath. In the 19th century, its warm healing waters made it a popular health resort. The listed building has been restored, but is not yet open to the public. We're going on a journey to discover all we can, and we'll be following the route of the Taff Trail. To commence our exploration, we must begin at the Taff Estuary. Today, an artificial lake has covered the tidal mudflats of the rivers Taff and Ely, following the completion of the multi-million pound barrage. The area is in a constant change of redevelopment. Cardiff Docks expanded in the early 19th century due to the flourishing coal and iron exports. Although some commercial docks remain, the Tiger Bay of years ago has gone forever.
I'm saying goodbye. Tiger Bay. I'm taking my wife and my children away. I love this old place and the folks that I know. The jobs are all gone, ranking along the bay. The place is changing. I feel somewhat sad when I think of the bay and the times we had. I'd go down to the pilot, my friend from Peru, meet up with a Dutchman and some of his crew. Buy it off the ladies, drink up the ale, then spend the night in Tiger Bay jail. My shipmates have gone, and those days are past, when I'd jump on a ship and earn some honest grass. 4 months at a time was a lifetime away. My hometown, Tiger Bay. I'm saying goodbye to Tiger Bay. I'm taking my wife and my children away. This old place is changing. I feel somewhat sad when I think of the bay and the times we had. I'd go down the Mount Stewart, my friend from Peru, meet up with a Dutchman and some of his crew. Buy it off the ladies and drink up the ale, then spend the night in Tiger Bay jail.
Thank you. Today's small pleasure boats have replaced the ships, which arrived here from all over the world. The piers and signals are silent forever. The old pierhead building, with its ornate red brick architecture, has been lovingly restored to its former affluent glory. What was once Bute-Town and Tiger Bay has now been renamed Cardiff Bay, and we can enter the new visitor centre to see the plans for the future. The Norwegian church was constructed to provide a place of worship for Scandinavian sailors on their frequent visits to Cardiff Docks. Today it's an art centre with exhibitions, musical and theatrical performances, and a cafe. Lightship 2000 also provides refreshments for Cardiff Bay visitors. It was once anchored in the Bristol Channel to keep shipping away from the notorious sandbanks. Inside is a small chapel depicting Christ as the light of the world. Visitors are welcome to visit the engine room. The ship today is operated as a Christian charity. With the influx of visitors to the area, accommodation is provided at the St. David's Hotel. A whole range of eating places have opened, providing traditional fish and chips, continental cuisine, and delicious ice cream. Cardiff Bay is also the home of the National Assembly for Wales. County Hall overlooks Bute East Dock, no longer in use. The wharf, now part occupied as a restaurant and inn, is one of the few original buildings to survive. Running into the dock is the restored Glamorganshire Canal, now overlooked by new housing. It was completed in 1798 for the transportation of iron to Cardiff's first dock. The docks expanded further after the arrival of the railways, with today's Cardiff Bay Station being a short distance from the original Bute Street station. The old Clarence Road station site has now been landscaped. The Exchange is probably the grandest of the surviving buildings from the heyday of the docks. Most of the investment came from the landowners, the Bute Estate, and what remains today is a reminder of their wealth. Standing alongside classical buildings is the modern. Atlantic Wharf is a leisure village, providing a whole range of entertainment, including a multi-screen cinema. Techniquest Science Discovery Centre is a fascinating day out for all ages. From here, walkers and cyclists can follow the signposted Taff Trail. We leave Cardiff Bay and cross the Taff on the Clarence Road Bridge, which unfortunately replaced an attractive steel girder bridge in 1976. We follow the western bank of the river towards the city centre. Our total journey will be around 55 miles, ending at the county town of Brecon. Most of the route is traffic-free. After crossing Penarth Road, we can see the old Hancock's Brewery across the river, now taken over by Brains. We pass under the South Wales main line and cross Wood Street, where we have a close-up view of the new Millennium Stadium, which has replaced the much-loved Cardiff Arms Park. As well as rugby matches, it hosts soccer internationals, cup finals, concerts and other events. At Cardiff Bridge, we leave the Taff Trail and make our way to the city centre, official capital of Wales since 1957. Shopping is centred around the pedestrianised Queen Street. Labour MP and Aaron Bevan's achievements are commemorated with this statue. Gareth Edwards, international rugby hero during the 1970s, takes pride of place in the St. David's Shopping Centre. Over the last 20 years, large sections of the city have been demolished and replaced by new shopping malls. However, some of the old Victorian and Edwardian arcades remain, containing small specialist shops. High Street and St. Mary Street have also been left largely untouched. If you look up, above shop floor level, you can but admire the traditional style of architecture. The market was rebuilt in 1891 and has a balcony on the upper floor. The stalls sell a whole range of goods, including meat and fish, fruit and veg, flowers, giftware, confectionery, and books. The old library is also one of the city's finest buildings architecturally, and today has a variety of uses, including exhibitions. The parish church, dedicated to St. John the Baptist, was founded in medieval days and rebuilt several times. The 15th century West Country style tower is currently being restored. The church is open for lunchtime refreshments. Hayes Island Snack Bar is the city's original outdoor cafe feature, although today many new eating and drinking establishments also provide a resting place for city centre workers and weary shoppers. St. David's Hall, one of many places offering high-class entertainment, has a uniquely styled tiered auditorium. The Cardiff International Arena has visits from top-name artists from all over the world. There's also a popular ice skating rink. There's a whole range of accommodation available throughout the area, including guest houses and a caravan site to cater for the ever-increasing numbers of visitors. Long-established traditional-looking hotels compete with the new luxury modern ones. As well as the railways carrying coal down the valleys to Cardiff Docks, Brunel's South Wales Railway main line arrived here from London in 1850, thus improving passenger links between England and Wales. Inkerthays Park is a statue of John Corey, coal owner and philanthropist. The charge of the Light Brigade at Balaclava is commemorated with this statue of Lord Tredegar on horseback. It overlooks the Civic Centre, Cardiff City Hall was completed in 1906 in the neoclassical style and constructed of white Portland stone. It has an impressive dome and clock tower. Cattay's Park was acquired from the Bute Estate in 1898, and the Law Courts was one of the first buildings completed. The National Museum of Wales has fine archaeology, natural history and social history collections, and art galleries. The Welsh Office now provides the administration for the National Assembly. Nearby is the Temple of Peace Gardens, a place for relaxation, reflection, thought, and prayer. In Alexandra Park is this memorial resembling a temple from ancient Greece or Rome. It is in fact the National War Memorial for Wales. Across the park is another neoclassical building, part of the University of Wales. Cardiff is a thriving university city and has a separate College of Music and Drama. The Sherman Theatre is part of the university complex. In the city centre, the new theatre is the city's traditional theatre and presents a wide range of drama and musical productions. In the 3rd century AD, the Romans arrived here and constructed a rectangular stone fortress. In 1865, the rebuilding of Cardiff Castle commenced, and some Roman brickwork can be seen in the lower walls. After paying our admission fee, we can enter through this fine gatehouse. Inside the curtain wall, a section of Roman masonry has been left untouched for us to view today. The walls were 10 feet thick at the base, and the fortress covered a site of around 9 acres. Other Roman sites in the area include a villa at Ely and naval base at Barry. The Romans left before the end of the 4th century, and the curtain walls were left in their ruined state until the 3rd Marquess of Bute commissioned William Burges to rebuild them in the Roman style. To house the Marquess and his family, Burges constructed elaborate private apartments, which can be viewed but not photographed on guided tours. Visitors are welcome to view the exhibits in the Queen's Dragoon Guards Regimental Museum. One feature, left untouched by Burges, is the late 13th century Norman keep. After the Romans left the site, it was unoccupied for nearly 700 years, until the Norman baron, Robert Fitzhamon, arrived and built a timber fortress on a motte. It was attacked and burned by Welsh invaders on many occasions, before it was rebuilt in stone with the surrounding moat. One incident took place in 1158, when Ivar ap Meurig, Lord of St. Genneth, kidnapped the Norman lord and his countess. He only agreed to release them in exchange for an amnesty for his previous misdemeanors. The moat outside the northern walls connects with the dock feeder canal. The Butes first took over Cardiff Castle in 1776, when the west range of buildings were made habitable with the aid of the architect Capability Brown. However, this compared little with the lavish towers and ornamentation added by Burgess 100 years later, under the direction of the third Marquess. These Gothic architectural fantasies are as far removed from a rebuilt Roman fort as you could possibly get. However, these fairy tale follies are in some eyes the most striking feature of the castle. Pride of place has to go to the clock tower, and today is a timely reminder of their wealth and prosperity, funded from the sweat and toil of the miners, railwaymen, dockers, and sailors. Alongside the castle is the animal wall, said to have been constructed by the Butes at a time when the townsfolk were hoping for a zoo, the same as Bristol. We're leaving the city to continue on the Taff Trail, and you can follow a route on either side of the river. Staying on the eastern bank, our preferred route is through Bute Park, until 50 years ago, the private gardens of the Marquess. Inside is a stone circle, commemorating the visits of the nationalised Stedford of Wales to its capital city. A new footbridge connects with the route on the western bank. Across the river is the Welsh Institute of Sport. Sophia Gardens is the home of Glamorgan County Cricket Club, now in the process of a large redevelopment plan. For most of the Taff Trail, we'll be able to enjoy off-road walking and cycling, with large sections of the route being on disused railway lines and along canal towpaths. Above the weir is another new footbridge, connecting the paths on both sides of the river. There are also plenty of local trails en route, providing walkers with a good selection of circular walks. The path comes out at the busy Western Avenue. After crossing the bridge, we come to the entrance of Buncanna Fields, where walkers, following the western bank of the river, join us. The City of Cardiff Riding School is here, where expert tuition is provided. We cross the busy road and continue the Taff Trail along the western bank of the river. We leave the path to explore the city of Llandaff. The well was consecrated in the 6th century by St. Tilo, the second bishop of Llandaff. Dominating the skyline is the cathedral, founded in 1120 by Urban, the first Norman bishop. It took well over a century to complete, and further modifications took place until the 15th century. This fine Norman doorway survives. During the Civil War, it had the indignity of Cromwell's troops, using it as a beer house and a stable for their horses. It fell into ruin until the 18th century, when John Wood commenced its restoration in the Italianate style, with later architects favouring Gothic. The cathedral suffered severe damage from a German landmine in January 1941, resulting in a considerable amount of careful restoration work. Entering the cathedral, we can see on the reinforced concrete arch between the nave and choir, Sir Jacob Epstein's aluminium Christ in Majesty. Behind the altar is this fine Norman arch. Prior to the Reformation, pilgrims came to visit the shrine of St. Tilo. The bronze plaques, designed by Sir Frank Roper, show scenes from the saint's life. As with other cathedrals, we will find tombs and memorials to knights, saints, and bishops. Sir David Matthew, standard bearer to King Edward IV, fell in the Battle of Towton in 1461. St. Dufrick's tomb is decorated with a 13th century effigy. The lives of bishops down the ages are displayed in several different ways. This memorial commemorates the life of architect George Pace, whose fine work has restored the sanctuary following Hitler's destruction. This has enabled visitors today to appreciate the architecture of the past alongside new work. The Welsh Regiment Memorial Chapel is a new building constructed by George Pace. It costs in excess of £200,000 a year to maintain this historic cathedral, and all donations are gratefully received. Outside is a preaching cross, and like St. David's, the cathedral is situated in a hollow. On the green above is the city cross, reset here in 1897. It overlooks the ruined 12th century bell tower, which was restored in 1924, when the later adjoining buildings were demolished. In 1972, the grounds of the Bishop's Palace, sometimes referred to as Llandaff Castle, were opened to the public. It was constructed in the 13th century and is strategically placed to guard the river. It's said to have been destroyed by Owain Glyndŵr in the 15th century. Today there are several ancient inns providing meals and refreshment to locals and visitors alike. Llandaff has more of a village feel than that of a city. It was completely independent of Cardiff until Llandaff became the cathedral for the newly created city of Cardiff in 1905. Ministers of religion are trained at the Church in Wales Theological College of St. Michael and All Angels. The Cathedral School provides education and sporting activities for its students. Many fine buildings adorn the green. Although it is today completely surrounded by Cardiff's urban suburbs, it has not lost its sense of identity and individuality. From the beautifully sculptured war memorial, we can descend the Dean Steps and follow the path back to the riverbank and the Taff Trail. From the Weir, we continue to Llandaff Rowing Club, founded in 1879. The oldest in Wales. An annual regatta is held, although rowers can be seen in action throughout the year. Tuition is given in two-seater boats. Rowing Club, we follow the riverbank path to Bridge Road, where we cross the Taff to the eastern bank. Our route passes through Hayley Park playing fields, providing a whole variety of sporting facilities for the residents of Llandaff North. Above us is a disused railway bridge. With the worldwide demand for Welsh coal in the 19th and early 20th centuries, the Taff Valley was crisscrossed by railways, some of which survive to this day for passenger traffic. We leave the redundant line and follow the path through fields. The five-arched viaduct carries trains from Cardiff to Merthyr. Opened by the Taff Vale Railway in 1841, it was the first railway to operate into Cardiff. The Mellon Griffith water pump was erected in 1807 to lift water 11 feet from the Tin Plate Works feeder to the Glamorganshire Canal. It worked for 140 years and is considered one of the most important industrial remains in Europe. The 2-mile-long Mellon Griffith tram road opened around 1815 to carry iron ore from quarries to the tin plate works operated by the Harford family. It was later rebuilt as a light railway and remained in use until 1959. The Taff Trail follows the old track bed to Radawir. There's a fish pass for salmon and trout, which are now returning to the Taff. This was a good location to watch a steam special commemorating the 150th anniversary of the Taff Vale Railway. From the information board providing details of the Mellon Griffith Light Railway, it's only a short distance to the Mellon Griffith Canal feeder. This is where the Glamorganshire Canal obtained its water supply. If you wish, you can leave the main Taff Trail route and follow the towpath alongside the feeder canal. It's now a nature reserve, with maps indicating the walks available. There's a hide, where we can view the lake and its wildlife. Here, the Mellon Griffith feeder flows into the Glamorganshire Canal. We turn left and follow the towpath. This is one of the few sections remaining which haven't been filled in. The canal was financed by Merthyr's ironmasters Crawshay, Humphrey and Guest to carry iron from their works to Cardiff Docks. The first section to Abercynon opened in 1794 and reached Merthyr 4 years later. These are the only two locks surviving. From the second lock, we follow the path to the road, where we rejoin the Taff Trail and pass under the M4 motorway. The footbridge crossing the river once carried the Mellon Griffith tram road. We have our first view of Castle Coch, our next place of interest. We don't cross the bridge, but follow the lane towards the village of Tonguinlais. We pass under the busy A470 dual carriageway. The village once had a mansion, home to Mary Ann Wyndham Lewis, wife of Benjamin Disraeli. In 1868, Queen Victoria created her Viscountess Beaconsfield. The parish church, dedicated to St. Michael and All Angels, only has one bell remaining in the twin bell-coated tower. There's a chip shop and several inns providing food, the first opportunity we've had to stop since Llandaff. We make our way up Castle Road and take the path up through the woods alongside the golf course. This brings us to Castle Coch, the Red Castle. It's sited on the ruined remains of the 13th century fortification constructed by Gilbert, Earl of Gloucester, although none of the original castle survives. What we see today is a Victorian folly created from the romantic fantasies of the third Marquess of Bute. He had a passion for medieval architecture, and in 1871 commissioned William Burgess, architect of his Cardiff Castle recreation, to turn a ruin into a fairy tale castle in the woods. Unfortunately, Burgess died in 1881, before the interior work had commenced. His plans were followed by William Frame, and we can marvel at his elaborate handiwork today. His eye for detail was incredible. Walking through here, you can really let your imagination wander back to your own childhood. The octagonal drawing room is emblazoned with scenes from Aesop's fables. The blue and gold ribbed vaulted ceiling is spangled with butterflies and birds. Despite the incredible expense involved in this unique creation, the Buttes spend little time here, regarding it as their country summer house. Course, the Taff Trail climbs up through the woodland of Forest Vale. We descend to a disused railway bridge. This enables walkers from Taff's Well to join the route. We continue on the track bed of the Barry Railway, past Tiru Farm, dating back to pre-industrial revolution days. The Barry Railway was constructed to take coal traffic direct to Barry's new docks. Severe congestion was taking place at Cardiff, where trainloads of coal were held up in the sidings for days on end. This section opened in 1901, and in its heyday, up to 90 coal trains a day made their way to Barry. It was a popular route for excursion traffic to Barry Island. The last passenger special steamed through in summer 1964. We leave the Barry line and continue on the track bed of the Rumney Railway's Taff's Well to Caerphilly branch. We leave the old line and cross the Caerphilly Road at Nantgarrow. It's worthwhile leaving the trail here to visit the Taff Valley's newest museum. A footbridge takes us over the busy A470. Years ago, the Glamorganshire Canal carried the traffic alongside the Nantgarrow China Works. Today it's a museum, and we're welcome inside to hear of its history. William Billingsley had a dream to create the finest porcelain in the world. In 1813, he opened his works here alongside the canal. It only operated for 7 years, but was reopened in 1833 by the Pardo family, producing earthenware pottery. It became one of the most successful potteries in Wales until its closure in 1920. It opened as a museum in 1993 and now produces clay pipes and modern pottery. There's an upstairs gallery which is also used for educational talks and a well-equipped shop. Retracing our steps to Caerphilly Road, we can continue on the Taff Trail. This time we're following the track bed of the old Pontypridd, Caerphilly and Newport Railway to the site of Upper Bolt Holt. It later changed its name to the Alexander, Newport and South Wales Docks and Railway, which is quite a mouthful. It operated its services on a shoestring, purchasing Wild West saloons from Buffalo Bill Cody's circus train to operate its passenger services. We pass through Reeder Velling, which means yellow ford, a reference to the iron-rich clay soil. After a 3.5-mile walk on the old line, we come to Glyntaf Crematorium. Cremation was legalized after Dr. William Price of Llantrisant won his court case following the cremation of his infant son. He erected two towers here, intending them to become part of a druidic museum. Adjoining is the cemetery and the parish church of Glyntaf, dedicated to St. Mary. We descend the steps and continue along Pentrebach Road, deafened from the noise of the dual carriageway traffic. At Oddfellows Place, you can leave the Taff Trail and climb up the steps to a lane. This leads to the Cottage Hospital. It overlooks the common where Dr. William Price held his druidic ceremonies. The stone circle was claimed by Iolo Morgannwg to have been the only true site of the ancient Gorseth, or assembly of bards. On the summit is the War Memorial, dedicated to the memory of the 5th Battalion of the Welsh Regiment. Below us is the town of Pontypridd. We descend to Merthyr Road, then follow the official Taff Trail route down Ynys Angharad Road. The Mission Hall supplied the spiritual needs for Brown Lennox employees, the world-famous chainmakers. We enter Ynys Angharad Park, one of the finest urban parks in Wales. These statues, crafted by William Goscombe John, are dedicated to two weavers, Evan James and his son John, composers of Mein Heinlad Fy Nadai, the Welsh national anthem. The park is particularly popular in summer, especially with younger visitors. There's a paddling pool and slide, with lifeguards present to keep an eye on the children. There's crazy golf and a pitch and putt course. The flower beds and hanging baskets are immaculately kept. For the energetic, there's tennis courts. The bowling club caters for those who prefer their sport at a somewhat gentler pace. Pontypridd Cricket Club occasionally hosts matches featuring Glamorgan County Cricket Club, and these games always draw large crowds. In 1999, Glamorgan batted first against their opponent Surrey in the CGU League. From Jack Callis's first shot for four, we knew that we would be in for a memorable afternoon's entertainment. However, as Surrey were top of the league, we did not expect to see history being made as Glamorgan went on to secure an emphatic victory. Autumn is a good time to sit and watch grey squirrels feeding. From the park, we take the footbridge over the Taff to the town centre, where we will find major retailers alongside local family-run businesses. The subway murals recognise the vast variety of musical talent produced locally, including international singing star for over 35 years, the one and only Tom Jones, and from the world of opera, Sir Geraint Evans. Pontypridd has a fine indoor market, a catalyst for people from the surrounding Rhondda valleys. A whole range of fresh produce is available. On Wednesdays and Saturdays, shoppers arrive from even further afield, hoping to find a bargain or two. The streets come alive with the outdoor market, a centuries-old tradition. Pontypridd is the home of the University of Glamorgan, originally founded in 1913 as the South Wales and Monmouthshire School of Mines. The railway station was once a hive of activity. Sprinter trains have replaced the age of steam. Fortunately, the canopy and platform buildings have survived, although they are not all in use. It's still a junction, with Brunel's fine stone viaduct surviving today. The Rhondda branch goes to Treherbert and the other to Merthyr. Dominating the skyline is the tower and steeple of the parish church. It's dedicated to St. Catherine and constructed of local stone. Another fine building is the municipal hall, housing the council offices. However, it's the chapels which display a wealth of architectural styles. Some are still open for worship, whilst others have been converted to secular use. This is now an art centre. Tabernacle Welsh Chapel is now the town's historical and cultural centre. fortunately, the chapel's interior has been retained for us to appreciate today. Nonconformity played a large part in the lives of the inhabitants of the South Wales valleys during the 19th and early 20th centuries, as did membership of a trade union. Pontypridd is essentially a 19th century town, which prospered from coal and iron until the Depression, when the population declined. A new industrial estate opened at nearby Treforest in the 1950s. Today, the Rhondda's only surviving coal mine is now a museum. This chapel was built in 1861. After closure as a place of worship, it reopened in 1986 to paint pictures in the eyes of today's visitors, recording its former glory when Pontypridd was regarded as being the capital of the valleys. As well as portraying the industrial past, sporting and musical achievements are also recorded. Pontypridd means bridge by the earthen house, although locals just refer to it as Ponty. William Edwards's graceful bridge was said to be the largest single arch bridge in the world when it was constructed in 1756. After crossing the Taff, we continue on our walk up the valley. It's signposted along a succession of side streets. After about 10 minutes, we come to Pont Zion Norton, where this railway bridge once carried trains on the Taff Vale Railway's branch to Nelson. We leave the rows of terraces behind us and take the path through fields. In the distance, nestling below the mountain, is Kilvanith. Our path leaves the riverbank, passes the rugby ground, crosses over the A470, and continues along a minor road. After a mile, we turn left, cross the dual carriageway again, and head towards Abercynon, once a thriving mining community. As its name suggests, it's situated where the Taff meets with the Cannon Valley. The navigation colliery and canal basin stood here, with the inn sign being our only visible reminder of this. Outside the fire station is a monument recording the achievements of railway pioneer Richard Trevithick, an employee of Merthyr ironmaster Samuel Humphrey. He made a 500 guinea wager with fellow iron baron Richard Crawshay that a 10-ton load of iron could be hauled by steam propulsion down the 4-foot 2-inch gauge Penydarran tramway. On the 21st of February 1804, Trevithick's locomotive succeeded in hauling the pig iron in 5 wagons, together with 70 men on them, down the tramway from Merthyr to Abercynon. The train returned to Merthyr with the empties. This was the first railway journey in the world by steam locomotive. A replica of the loco is seen steaming at the Welsh Industrial and Maritime Museum, Cardiff, which unfortunately has now closed down. The road under the bridge goes into Abercynon town centre, whilst the Taff Trail follows the Penydarran tram road. It opened in 1802 using horse-drawn wagons and ran for a total distance of 9.5 miles from Merthyr's Ironworks to the canal basin at Abercynon. The tram road overcame the problem of congestion on the canal and shortened the journey time to Cardiff Docks. These three feeder pipes fed water into the Glamorganshire Canal. Trevithick's steam locomotive made further trips down the line, but had to be withdrawn from service as it was too heavy and damaged the cast iron rails. The line was relaid in 1832 and steam traction reintroduced. By the end of the century, all of Merthyr's ironworks had closed, leaving this historical line redundant. The tram road crossed the Taff on the Victoria Bridge, which replaced a timber structure in 1815 and entered the unusually named Quaker's Yard. To unravel our mystery, we have to leave the trail and cross the Taff again on the narrow road bridge. Below the road is the site of a Quaker's burial ground. The religious group established their own community here around 1650, when they were persecuted for opposing the state religion. If you wish, you can cross the Bargoed Taff to the Quaker's Yard Inn, wondering what the religious founders would have thought of their faith being associated with a public house. There's a local trail connecting Quaker's Yard with the old pit villages of Treelewis and Treharris. The site of Deep Navigation Colliery is now being flattened in readiness for a new road. After the opening of the colliery, Bontnewydd was renamed Treelewis after local farmer William Lewis. The parish church is dedicated to St. Mary and has a single bell-coated tower. Treharris is named after William Harris, the colliery chairman, who provided the village with the public hall and institute. He came from a rich Quaker family who owned steamships, but was excommunicated after he married a non-Quaker. At the Taff Trail Inn, we continue on the Penydarran tram road, which closely follows the course of the River Taff. We cross the river again on a single arched stone bridge, which also replaced a timber one after a train collapsed on it. Crossing the river and tram road is the Edwardsville Viaduct, designed by Brunel for the Taff Vale Railway. It opened in 1841 and still carries Cardiff to Merthyr trains. It was later widened to carry double track, but has now been singled again. This section is one of the loveliest on the entire route. We pass the abutments of two more railway viaducts, whose lines, like the ironworks and collieries, are but a memory today. Both were operated by the Great Western Railway, with the second being part of a joint line with the Rumney Railway. Pairs of stone blocks, which carried the Penydarran and tramway rails, can be seen today, together with the imprints of the rails and the steel pegs which held them in position. There were three blocks at the points, and four along the passing loops, of which there were 15 between Abercynon and Mount Pleasant alone. Particular care is necessary when cycling along this section. The tram road passed under the road at Pontygwaith. We leave it here and cross the Taff on the humpback stone bridge, erected in 1811 to provide access to the local ironworks. The official route takes you under the A470, then climbs the hill to follow the route of the Glamorganshire Canal. However, walkers can take the footpath after crossing the river and follow the path through the fields. This brings us to the riverbank. Across the river is Mount Pleasant. At Ynys Owen, we can see the arches of the Penydarran tram road below the Taff Vale railway line. As we approach Abervan, we meet up again with the official route. The war memorial commemorates those who lost their lives in the Korean War, as well as the two world wars. Prior to that fateful day on the 21st of October 1966, Abervan was a little known Welsh coal mining village. However, when an old tip came crashing down on Pantglass Junior School and adjoining houses, the whole world wept with this little community. 116 children and 28 adults lost their lives. This spotlessly kept memorial garden is a permanent reminder of that fateful day. Children's play facilities and a new leisure centre have been provided from the vast sum of money collected for the community. A new school has been built nearby, and slag tips throughout Wales have been removed, and the valley's landscaped. Our walk continues on the route of the Glamorganshire Canal. Unfortunately, it's been filled in, and only a narrow channel of water remains today. Next village is Troyderoo. The parish church is dedicated to St. John the Baptist. Back in the 5th century AD, Rhian, Drumreath and Rowan, sons of Prince Brecon of Merthyr, were killed by Picts while defending members of their family, including their sister, Tydvil. Pontarine Bridge marks the spot where the tragedy occurred. The railway station survives, although the days of steam-hauled trains are long gone, and the station buildings have been demolished. Our journey continues on the route of the Glamorganshire Canal. It's only a short walk to Aberconnaid. The first church was dedicated to St. Peter and St. Paul in 1882. Since 1912, it's been a hall, after a larger church was built to replace it. The village was originally named Llwyna Eos, Nightingale Grove, which lives on as the name of the 18th century inn. At Pond Row, the canal-side cottages built to house colliery workers survive today. The Plymouth Ironworks were operated by Sir William Thomas Lewis, Baron Merthyr of St. Genneth. He was born at Aberconnaid House and later became one of the most powerful colliery owners, owning the Lewis Merthyr Mines in the Rhondda. We can compare his mansion with the small cottages of Key Row, which housed the workers. It's worthwhile leaving the canal at the lane and taking the bridge across the Taff. At Trevithick's Tunnel, the Penydarin tram road passed the Plymouth Ironworks, operated by Richard Hill. Iron smelting commenced here in 1763 and continued until 1880. The site of the works has today been landscaped. Crossing back over the Taff, we rejoin the Taff Trail where we left it, at the lane. Again, we follow the route of the canal. The bridge carried the Great Western Railway line from Merthyr to Neath. Redecar Leisure Centre has a bowls club, health suite and three swimming pools, as well as hosting concerts and shows. The subway murals portray scenes from Merthyr's history. In the middle of the 18th century, it was a tiny village. By 1801, due primarily to its ironworks, it had become the largest town in Wales. Workers arrived from as far away as Ireland, Spain, and Italy to obtain employment. The last mural shows today's walkers and cyclists on the Taff Trail. The canal passed Anisfach Ironworks. Today Merthyr has a college of further education. Standing opposite is the new fire station. One old building still standing is the Anisfach Engine House. It was constructed in 1801 to house a beam engine providing blasts of air to the Anisfach furnaces. It has been restored as an Iron Heritage Centre. The old Georgetown tip has been landscaped and trees planted. The Three Horseshoes dates from 1795. By 1850, there were a total of 305 inns in Merthyr. Chartist meetings were held here, with the nearby Court of Requests being attacked many times when it held prisoners during the Merthyr riots. Today, it's been converted into a public house. The only original 19th century cottages still standing in Georgetown are at Chapel Row. Number 4 is particularly important as it was the birthplace of Dr. Joseph Parry in 1841. He was the composer of hymn tunes such as Aberystwyth and the love song Mavanwy, still popular with choirs today. Outside the house, a small section of the Glamorganshire Canal has been restored, with the iron bridge coming from Redeca. To make our way into the town centre, we cross over Jackson's Bridge, erected in 1793 by the Dowlas Iron Company. It originally carried a tram road. In the mid-19th century, Merthyr had 84 churches and chapels, of which 65 were nonconformist. Most have gone now. Life in those days was hard. There were epidemics and poor social conditions. It is no surprise that riots broke out. In 1831, a violent crowd gathered outside the Castle Inn. A soldier died during the skirmish that followed. The authorities were determined that someone should hang for this crime. Richard Lewis, a 23-year-old miner known as Dick Penderyn, was found guilty of the offence, which he did not commit. His life ended on the gallows at Cardiff Jail. A plaque outside the Carnegie Library commemorates this martyr of the Welsh working class. The site originally housed a ragged school, and the statue of Lord Buckland, Henry Seymour Berry, graces the courtyard. Adjoining is the town hall, erected in 1896, an attractive building constructed of red brick. It has a distinctive clock tower. To commemorate the marriage of the Prince of Wales in 1863, a fountain was installed outside the Gothic-styled St. David's Church, the parish church of Merthyr, since the 1840s. The Miners' Hall, however, has been allowed to fall into decay. Although many of the traditional buildings have survived, a large section of the town centre has been rebuilt and pedestrianised. Most of the shops and a supermarket are located in this area. Above the shopping centre is the market hall. A walk down High Street, past the Baptist Chapel, still preaching the gospel today, will take us towards the oldest settlement in the town, known as the village. The early 19th century church seen today replaced an earlier Norman sanctuary. It's dedicated to St. Tydfil, daughter of the Welsh prince Brecon. Despite claims that she was martyred for her beliefs, the name Merthyr is derived from the Latin martyrium, which means burial place. Merthyr Tydfil is therefore the final resting place of Tydfil, not the town of Tydfil the martyr. The iron fountain commemorates Robert and Lucy Thomas, local pioneers of the steam coal trade. Welsh steam coal was in demand all over the world to power ships and train locomotives. There are plenty of buses to explore the area. All the railway sidings and marshalling yards have gone. Just a single platform remains for Cardiff trains. The arrival of the railway coincided with Merthyr's boomtown period. Many classical-style buildings remain today, including banks and, surprisingly, a rather impressive-looking McDonald's. The buildings have a wide range of architectural styles. Many have changed from their original use. I wonder what the founders of the Temperance Hall would have thought of it being used today as a bingo hall. This is Thomastown, now a conservation area. This striking Art Nouveau Gothic building was once the Unitarian Chapel. A fitness center now occupies the Twin Tower Synagogue, a reminder of the once thriving Jewish community. Richard Trevithick's achievements have not been overlooked. Penydarren Road stands on the route of the tramway. On the centenary of the Cornishman's death, this monument was erected using chair stones and rails recovered from the tramway. On the hill opposite is Penydarren Park, once the site of a Roman fort, and Ironmaster Samuel Humphrey's mansion. The war memorial stands here. Adjoining is the Masonic Temple, with its distinctive Doric columns. Merthyr's football team also have their home on the hill. From Pontmorlais Circus, we leave the town centre and make our way along Pontmorlais West, past St. Mary's Church to Brecon Road. Tabernacle Chapel has stood here since 1898, when it replaced an earlier sanctuary founded by a group of disaffected Welsh Baptists. This brings us to the district of Cyfartha and its park, with distinctive wrought iron railings. Today it's open to the public, with the lake and its ducks being popular with the younger visitors. Cyfartha Castle, designed by London architect Richard Lugar, was completed in 1825 at a cost of £30,000 as the home of ironmaster William Crawshay II. Cyfartha Ironworks were then the largest in the world. It is today a museum and art gallery. Our tour begins in the basement, where displays tell the story of Merthyr's iron-making history and the later coal mining industry. As well as having the kitchen, larders and pantries, the servants had their quarters here. Altogether, there were 72 rooms. On the ground floor were three drawing rooms and a library. Today, works of art adorn the walls. The castle had its own dairy, ice house, brewery, and hothouses for fruit growing. This provided income for the upkeep of the property. Building of the castle only took 12 months to complete. Whilst Crawshay was a wealthy man, he is not overindulged to the extent of Lord Bute at Cardiff and Castle Cork, but was nevertheless a keen collector. The castle has 365 windows, one for each day of the year. Rosemary Crawshay, wife of Robert, was a visionary woman. She believed in women's rights, the ending of class divisions, cremation, and euthanasia. She personally provided 7 libraries for the community. In a room at the ironworks, she entertained the workers with literature and music. Outside the main entrance is a 2/3 replica model of Trevithick's pioneering steam locomotive. The castle was purchased by Merthyr Corporation in 1909, when it was converted into a school and museum. The fountain was presented to the town at the end of the First World War. It's delightful to stroll around the 160-acre grounds, where the flower beds are immaculately kept. There's a bandstand, bowling green, and tennis courts. There's 2 play areas for the youngsters. Older children can play football or develop their golfing skills.
Oh, that's a good shot.
Walking is popular, whatever the time of year, with a variety of wildflowers to be seen. In summer, local model railway enthusiasts give train rides on their replica scale model locomotives. Opposite the park's main entrance is Pandy Farm, dating from 1766. It's on the site of a 14th century fowling mill. The clock tower dates from 1816 and has since been rebuilt. Here we rejoin the Taff Trail, which proceeds along Brecon Road. The Taff splits in two at Merthyr, and the bridge takes us across the Taff Brecon. From the Kefancoyd sign at the mini roundabout, you can turn left past a housing estate and a playing field to the banks of the Taff Vowel. Upstream, we can see the graceful arches of the Kefancoyd Viaduct, standing 115 feet above the river. A riverside path leads under it to the village. Alternatively, you can cross the river on the footbridge and climb the steep path to the top of the hill. Here, the cycle track takes us across the 3rd longest viaduct in Wales. It was constructed in 1866 at a cost of £25,000 to carry the railway from Merthyr to Brecon. It's built of stone, except for the arches, which are brick, due to a strike by the stonemasons. It's curved to avoid crossing Crawshay's land. A block of 1960s flats stand on the site of Kefancoyd Station. Prior to the arrival of the railway, Kefancoyd was on the route of the drovers, who herded their cattle from West Wales to the English beef markets. The parish church was built on land given by Mrs. Anne Halford and dedicated to St. John the Baptist. The tall spire can be seen for miles around. It was constructed by David Jenkins of Merthyr using locally quarried stone and completed in 1874. It has undergone many alterations since. A railway bridge takes us across the busy A465 Heads of the Valleys Road, where we continue on the old railway track bed. Walkers can take an alternative route through the Taffechan Nature Reserve. The path descends to the riverbank. The ruined walls are all that's left of Gurnos Mill. Across the river stood Gurnos Quarries, which supplied limestone to the Cyfartha Ironworks furnaces. Water was fed from the river and down the feeder to Cyfartha Castle Lake. A tramroad carried the limestone to the ironworks. Our walk continues in the opposite direction, where we follow the Taffechan upstream. There are paths both sides of the river, and an informative leaflet is available. Our riverside walk ends at the Blue Pool, popular with swimmers, but extreme caution is needed. We cross the bridge and climb the steps to the Pontsan Inn, previously the station master's house on the Brecon and Merthyr Railway. Pontsan station platform still survives. The Seven Arch Viaduct is constructed of locally quarried stone and was completed in 1866. It's 448 feet in length and stands 90 feet above the river. This is the last viaduct we cross on our journey. The arches of the viaduct, in the shape of a T, is the emblem of this walk. After crossing the viaduct, we can follow the Morlice Heritage Trail sign and climb up the steeply wooded Morlice Hill. At the top, we can rest a while and take in the superb views. These are the ruined quarries where tramroad sleepers can be seen. A further climb will take us to the summit, where we can just about make out the ruined walls of Morlice Castle. It was constructed on the site of an earlier Iron Age hill fort by Gilbert de Clare. Unfortunately, the land was owned by Earl Humphrey, resulting in open warfare between the two barons in 1290. The king imprisoned them both, and this underground vaulted crypt is the only feature of note for us to see today. The castle overlooks the golf course. It's possible that some of the walls were removed when quarrying began. Across the valley, we can see the small village of Vainor, with the original church now part of a private residence. The tower of the present St. Gwendolyn's Church, burial place of Robert Crawshay, can also be seen. We descend through the woods to rejoin the Taff Trail on the railway track bed. This is Morlaix Junction, where the LNWR branch line ran through the tunnel to Pennywern Junction, Dowler. The ruined signal box stands nearby. We leave the truck bed at the gate, where it becomes private land. The Taff Trail continues down the lane for a mile to Pontstithith Reservoir, where we join it later. The mountain stream is popular with drivers for washing their cars. We follow the lane uphill, where we can see a steam train on its way to Pant Station. This is the headquarters of the Brecon Mountain Railway, which opened in 1981 as a preserve line. A train service operates from Easter until the end of October. After purchasing our tickets, we can stop to view the spacious workshop where the passenger coaches were built. Routine repairs, servicing, and complete locomotive rebuilds are carried out, both for this railway and other preserve lines. A new station has been erected a short distance away from the original Pant Station on the Brecon and Merthyr Railway main line from Dowlas. Today's locomotive is Graf Schwerin Lewitz, built in East Germany in 1908. It's an 062 well tank and has been converted for oil burning. The trains today run on a gauge of 1 foot 11 and 3/4 inches. The first 600 yards of track are on a completely new alignment. We are now steaming along on what was once the standard gauge track bed of the original Brecon and Merthyr line. It opened in 1859, 10 years before the branch to Merthyr via Kefancoyd. It was absorbed by the Great Western in 1922 and closed in 1964. Thank you. The old Ponce de Cith signal box now provides B&B accommodation for visitors. This was the terminus for trains when the Preserve Line first opened. Trains no longer stop here on the outward journey since the extension opened to Dolegaia. Thank you. travelled a total of 3.5 miles from Pant to a temporary terminus at Dolagaya. The line here from Pontsdysith reopened in 1995. Work is currently taking place for a 2-mile extension to Top Antai. Dolagaya Mountain and Training Centre now occupy the original station site, once a popular stopping-off place for the annual regatta. Dolagaya Church, a chapel, cottages and small holdings were lost when the reservoir was constructed. The largest engine in use on the line is number 2, a 7-ton American-built 462 tender locomotive. It's seen in action after an April snowstorm. This is not unusual up in the mountains. A 20-minute stop is made at Pontsdysith on the return journey. Number 2 was built in July 1930 at the Baldwin Works, Philadelphia, USA. She was shipped to South Africa, where she spent her working life hauling limestone. We're leaving the railway here as we have a journey to complete. A walk down the lane takes us back onto the Taff Trail, which crosses the Pontsdysith Reservoir Dam, providing us with views of the snow-capped mountains. It's also known as the Taff Bechan Reservoir. Here we have an excellent view of the train returning to Pant Station. She is passing Pontsdysith Junction, where the line from Kefincoyd and Merthyr joined up with the main line from Dowlais and Pant. We climb up the hill above the reservoir, but do not pass through Pontsdysith village. We turn right on reaching the lane, then left onto a forestry track. We're now in the Brecon Beacons National Park. So far on this journey, there's been plenty of buses and trains available to take walkers back to their starting off point. This next section is taking us through the mountains, with no public transport available until we reach the Usk Valley at Talibont. Cyclists should take care when crossing the bridge over the Nangkar Var. track descends gently towards the Talibont Road. We climb the hill above the picnic site, where the lane to Dolagaya separates the Ponsisith Reservoir from the Pentoyne Reservoir. This small chapel is now a private residence. The road descends to the Pentoyne Reservoir, smallest of the three seen on this journey. We leave the Talibont Road and follow the lane leading to the Nuath Reservoir. We descend to Birchhall Woods, where the Bothy has been restored to commemorate the 75th anniversary of the founding of the Forestry Commission. This takes us to the banks of the Taff Fetton. At the bridge, instead of climbing the road, we're taking the path past the waterfall and along the riverbank. We climb the hill and rejoin the road. In the distance we can see Cwm Ddu and Penyfan, the highest mountain in South Wales, 2,906 feet above sea level. This track was once an old Roman road. We turn around and follow the bridleway past the standing stone. We continue along the forestry track with excellent views of the Pentoyne and Talibont reservoirs. This leads to the old Torpentai station site, one of the remotest in Britain and now occupied by sheep pens. The Brecon Mountain Railway will need to erect a new bridge across the realigned Talibont Road. Work is already underway, extending the line here. We rejoin the Talibont Road to the summit of our walk, 1,440 feet above sea level. It's downhill now. We turn right onto a forestry track, which descends steeply to the northern portal of Torpentai Tunnel, the highest in the UK. The Brecon Mountain Railway plan to make this their terminus 5.5 miles from Pant. It overlooks Blaenau Glyn with its spectacular waterfall flowing into the river Caer Fanwl. Our walk continues on the old track bed. Across the valley, we have views of the Brecon Beacons. These are a mixture of cone-shaped mountains and a series of ridges. The summit of Craig of Andy, 2,040 feet above sea level, can be seen on a clear day. Below us is Talibont Reservoir. This stretch of railway line is known as the 7 Mile Bank. Between Torpontai and Talabont, it descends 925 feet at 1 in 38. From the bridge, we're leaving the track bed for a short while to take the path through the woods to the shore of the reservoir. Permits are required for fishing. Dogs and swimming are both prohibited. We follow the road as far as the dam. Cyclists have to leave us here, cross the dam and take the road through Abbe. Walkers can continue on the railway track bed. After crossing the bridge, we have to leave the old line and take the track on the right up the hill. We turn left onto the track bed of the Brinawa tramway, where some of the sleeper stones can still be seen. It opened in 1815, using horses to haul wagons to the Brecon and Abelveni Canal at Talabont. It closed 50 years later, after the Brecon and Merthyr Railway opened. We cross over the railway at Talabont. The bridges over the canal and road both remain. A walk down Station Road will take us to the Outdoor Education Centre. They occupy the old Talabont Station building. The platform and footbridge both survive. The rail bridge over the River Usk has gone. Only the foundations remain. Although its full name is Talabont on Usk, the village is 3/4 of a mile away from the Usk. The river flowing through it is the Carvanal, so it should really be named Talabont on Carvanal. Refreshment and meals can be obtained in Talabont's Inn. Cyclists arriving down the lane from Talabont Reservoir reach the village at the lift bridge, although there's a shorter route if they wish to avoid Talabont. The steel lift bridge has replaced a fixed bridge since the canal reopened in 1970. The official cycling route continues along the B4558 towards Brecon, although many cyclists unofficially join the walkers on the towpath of the Brecon and Abergavenny Canal. This is also the route of the Usk Valley Walk, another long distance hike from Caerleon to Brecon. The canal is navigable for 33 miles from Brecon to Pontymoel, near Pontypool. It was engineered by Thomas Dadford Jr. and opened in stages between 1797 and 1812. At Pontymoel, it connected with the Monmouthshire Canal from Newport. The two canal companies amalgamated in 1865. 15 years later, it was taken over by the Great Western Railway who renamed it the Monmouthshire and Brecon Canal. By the 1930s, the canal had become very run down and largely abandoned. Fortunately, British Waterways commenced a restoration project in 1968, and the canal was reopened 2 years later. At Penketley, there are moorings, with the stop at the Royal Oak being popular, whether you arrive by boat or on foot. Penketley Castle has caravan and camping facilities. From Penketley Slipway, you can leave the canal if you wish, and follow the footpath through fields to a lane. After half a mile, you come to Llanfaegan Church. It's popular with visiting bell ringers because of the excellent tone of the bells and its isolated location. The church dates from the 13th century and has a square Norman tower. After descending the lane, we rejoin the canal towpath. A two-arch aqueduct crosses the Nant Monaskin. After rounding a bend, we come to Llanfynach Wharf. Here, the Waterfolk Canal Centre have a working blacksmith, tea room, gift shop and canal museum. It tells the story of the canal and houses many interesting artifacts. The Dragon's Tail is a restored barge, giving boat rides to visitors 3 times a week during the summer months. All barges were horse-drawn when the canal first opened, and today's visitors can take a relaxing ride through the wonderful national park scenery. We pass the New to Newith Marina, operated by Cambrian Cruisers. Farmhouse accommodation is also available. After a pleasant three-quarter of a mile trip, the barge moors at Brynich. Passengers have time to stretch their legs before the return journey and can take a walk across the aqueduct. Four-arch Brynich Aqueduct was completed in 1800 and carries the canal across the River Usk. Crossing is the pleasure barge Dragonfly, returning to Brecon with its passengers on a 2.5 hour cruise, an enjoyable day out. Thank you. clock is the only one on the canal, apart from the Staircase of Five at Llanganada. The official Taff Trail route for walkers continues to Brecon along the canal towpath. However, we're leaving the canal here and following the footpath beside the River Usk. Taff Trail commenced in Cardiff, near the Glamorganshire Canal, and ends here at the terminus of the Brecon and Abergavenny Canal. When it reopened, Brecon's canal basin was derelict. Now, new housing overlooks the attractive waterfront setting. There's a new theatre and a bistro to relax after our long journey. Dragonfly Cruises operate their pleasure trips from here. The Welsh name for the town is Aberhondi, as it is here that the Hondi flows into the Usk. Above the confluence stands the Castle Hotel, built on the site of a Norman castle, founded in the 11th century. Some later stonework survives. Prince Brecon was defeated by the Normans, who established Brecon as a walled garrison town. The present bridge over the Usk was built in the 1970s and stands on top of the old bridge built in 1563. Alongside the river is the promenade, a popular place for relaxation. The Normans also built a Dominican friary, converted into Christ College by King Henry VIII in 1541, after the dissolution of the monasteries. Brecon has many interesting and historical buildings. Buckingham Place is claimed to be the oldest domestic property and was originally named the Great House. In the bulwark is the statue of the Duke of Wellington, which overlooks the hotel named after him. Sarah Siddons, a famous actress, was born at this inn in 1755. St. Mary's Parish Church dates primarily from the 14th century and has a 90-foot early 16th century perpendicular tower. The new east window depicting Christ in glory was completed in 1989. A half-sized dog door can be seen within the porch door. Standing above the town is Brecon Cathedral, founded in 1093 by Baron Bernard de Newmarch, half-brother of William the Conqueror. It's dedicated to St. John the Evangelist, and most of the external stonework seen today dates from the 13th and 14th centuries. The nave is in 14th century decorated style with octagonal piers. In the sanctuary is the 20th century carved reredos. The Harvard Chapel is used by the Royal Regiment of Wales as their regimental chapel. A Celtic church stood on the site prior to the Normans establishing a Benedictine priory. After the dissolution, it served the community as a parish church until it became the cathedral of the Diocese of Swansea and Brecon in 1923. Since then, restoration and repair work has taken place, with the sanctuary today being both a reminder of the faith of earlier generations and the spiritual home of a living Christian community. In the close is a Christian Heritage Centre, restaurant and shop. The market hall opened in 1857 and has an attractive entrance. The Guildhall dates from 1770, with alterations taking place in 1888 to house the council chamber. The town also has shops, banks, a cinema and library. The Brecknock Museum is housed in the Shire Hall, built in 1842, and has distinctive Doric columns. The County Museum moved its collection here in 1974 after it had outgrown its previous building. Displays cover architecture, social, and cultural history. There's a fine collection of love spoons. The Roman fort and the island in Llangors Lake have been excavated. Archaeological finds include coins, pottery, and gravestones. The Assize Court was held here until 1971, and the courtroom has been preserved. The museum also has an art gallery and natural history displays. Part of the barracks is now the South Wales Borderers and Monmouthshire Regimental Museum of the Royal Regiment of Wales. Every August, the UK's number one jazz festival is held here. The streets come alive with the sound of music. We'll be right back. performances are held at venues all over the town, with top artists appearing from all over the world. All styles are presented, with many of the events being free. We hope you've enjoyed sharing our journey along the Taff Trail. Here at Brecon Jazz, we can join in the 3-day festivities before making our way home for a well-deserved rest. Yeah.